Yes, it's the wide, glorious world of sports. From 37 camera angles, slow motion, and instant replay, today's popular sports are made even more popular by high visibility primetime exposure. In short, more are watching and less are playing. Why, in the history of the NFL, only 22,000 men have ever played football in the league. Another reason for the lack of participation are the costs. Costs of equipment, costs of the arena, costs of insurance. But what would you say if I told you there was a sport that costs practically nothing? A sport whose playing field is as available as a town park. A sport where parents and children can compete together. And most importantly, a sport that develops the mind as well as the body. It's called orienteering, and it takes place in the woods. The Swedes call it skogsport, or forest game. Using a compass and a detailed map, orienteers navigate through unfamiliar terrain, looking for orange and white flags, or controls. These flags are hung on certain geographical features that must be visited in order. You're clocked out and clocked in. The fastest time wins. Imagine a combination of a treasure hunt and a road rally, all in the woods. You compete at your own age and ability level, advancing to more difficult courses only after you've proved to yourself you're able. So you want to try orienteering? Well, this is all you'll need. That's right, a map and a compass. Of course, there's a lot of behind-the-scenes work that we won't get into right now, like making the map, designing the course, and hanging the flags in the woods. This is what a typical orienteering course looks like. Circles connected by lines. The triangle shows you where you are when you start. At the center of each circle is where you'll find the flag. And the straight lines show you the fastest route as the crow flies. As courses get harder, they also get longer, testing your map reading ability as well as your physical stamina. Elite class orienteering would use a course such as this. Intricate and detailed map reading over a demanding 10-kilometer course. But don't get scared away. Understanding a map is as easy as understanding its symbols. Maps are naturally color-coded. Blue is water, green is vegetation, black is rock and man-made features like houses, brown is contours, yellow is open land, and white is common runnable forest. Now, with this little knowledge of the map, let's go up in the air and see just what a crow sees. Because a map is a two-dimensional representation of a bird's-eye view, when you learn to read the contour lines, you'll instantly see the changes in elevation. And soon, it all makes sense. The map and the ground become one. How did such an unusual sport get its beginnings? Well, as best we can tell, it started in Sweden at the early part of this century. During the early years, orienteering was basically a military training exercise. But on March 25, 1919, Major Ernst Killander of the Swedish military held the first orienteering race outside of Stockholm with 220 participants. It wasn't long before the sport of orienteering took hold and spread throughout Scandinavia and eventually the world. The first European championship was held in 1962. In 1968, the first world championship, and entry to the Olympics is just around the corner. Why, orienteering has spread literally around the world. The 1985 World Championship was held in Australia. Last summer, over 25,000 people of all ages took part in Sweden's O-Ringen, a five-day orienteering event. The world's most populous country could end up being its biggest supporter. So what's an orienteering event really like? Let's go to the starting line of the 1987 United States Championships held in Western Rhode Island and see. These people are all awaiting their individual start times. Since there are sometimes 8 different courses set in the woods, you'll see a number of different level runners leave the line simultaneously and in different directions. You're given a time at which you're to report to the line and receive your map. Then you're off. If you've never tried it, believe me, there is nothing like finding that first control. On your way through your course, you're sure to pass all sorts of people. Of course, the object of the game is to find the control. To prove you were there, you must punch your control card with the identifying punch hanging from each flag. But what is it really like? Well, the most important thing to remember is that the race does not always go to the swift, but sometimes to the clever. Orienteers are constantly forced to make decisions about their choice of route. Here's a very common route choice. You must get from circle to circle with that big hill in the way. The safest way is to go around, sticking to the flat trail, but increasing your distance by maybe 30%. A strong orienteer with good map reading ability might choose to take a more direct route, up and over the hill, on a beeline to the flag. To make matters more interesting, the more you exert yourself, the more your decision-making capability suffers. So make a gross error and your problems will compound themselves. But back to the race. You know, that's actually a misnomer, because you don't have to race. Many people love to come out and find their flags at a leisurely pace. We call it map hiking. From families with young kids to an elderly couple on a nature walk, orienteering is what you make it. Why, just ask these kids how much fun it is. Nothing beats the excitement of the finish line for the people watching and those finishing. After the run-in, everyone gravitates to the results board to see how they fared. And somehow, it doesn't really matter where you placed. Everyone's a winner. Run your first orienteering course and you'll feel a certain camaraderie with other runners, almost like you're veterans. Amble back to your car and maybe buy a new compass, a club shirt, or a training book from one of the traveling merchants. And we can't forget the kids. In an effort to start map reading as early as possible, youngsters are encouraged to try the Stringo course. Kids have their own mapping course, just 300 or 400 yards. No need to worry, Mom. All they have to do is follow the ribbon. So, if you're looking for a sport that you can get out and play with just a minimum of experience, a sport that costs literally pennies to play, and a sport that teaches decision-making, self-reliance, and the love of the outdoors, then try Orienteering. All are welcome.
Kangaroo!